I'm a fan of all sports, you know, and I watch these guys. I'm a big fan. The thing that I love the most is what we're doing now. I get to understand their minds and see how that correlates with what I use to play the game, you know, and that now when I watch them on TV, you know, I can almost know what they're thinking because I've heard the similarities in our personalities and the way that we prepare ourselves for battle. And except for Roy, I know he's out to kill. Whoever's dumped in that ring, he's got that mentality.
It's a science. It's a science.
Okay, you call it a science. I call it a crime.
They are different in many ways, from Carolina to Compton.
The Serena slam is hers, the title holder of all four major championships.
They have been brutal.
There is none more fierce than Roy Jones Jr.
And beautiful.
The greatest player of all time, the likes of which we may never see again.
Smooth.
He is Mr. November.
And savage.
Warren Sapp.
How athletic and how fast.
But they're all bound together by one word. Champion. Tonight, I'll sit down with five of the top athletes in the world.
That's all.
Derek Jeter. At age 29, he has nearly enough World Series rings to fill an entire hand. He's the consummate team player, savvy, versatile, and driven by a fierce desire to win. Serena Williams, her combination of power, passion, and grace, has earned her 6 Grand Slam titles and made her the most dominant force in women's tennis. Warren Sapp, bold and brash, he's been bashing quarterbacks for almost a decade. A perennial Pro Bowler who may be the most athletic player ever at his position. Roy Jones Jr., pound for pound, he ranks high among the greatest boxers of all time. No one is more feared in his sport, and that's exactly the way he likes it. Michael Jordan, simply the NBA's greatest ever. Tonight, we'll talk about talent, celebrity, family, obsessions, and everything in between. Five of the greatest athletes of our generation together in one room for the first time. Keep on trying till I reach my highest ground.
First of all, let's talk about dominating the opponent. There's just something about each and every one of you. Because I know, because you and I have been hanging out a long time. I know your whole thing is to dominate your opponent.
No, I mean, we train to be the best at what we do. And sometimes to be the best, you gotta step on people. Not step on them literally, but I mean, in terms of winning and dominating, we all see it the same in our different professions. I mean, obviously individual, the rest of us a team, we gotta rely upon our team, but that doesn't change our individual work ethic. I mean, we gotta go out and try to be the best no matter what.
Serena, what's your approach?
You just have to have an attitude about it. Like when I'm playing different people, when I saw in the World Series, I saw that Derek had this different attitude as opposed to some of the rest of the people on the team. Like, it's just this attitude that I really want to win as opposed to I kind of want to win, I kind of want to dominate. It's all about attitude to me.
Your attitude definitely changes come playoff time.
You think so?
Yes.
Yeah,
without
question. We don't
call anybody
somebody
back.
Without question. Yeah, you can get him on the phone all during the season.
Nobody.
Come to playoffs, it's all over with.
Swung and a drill to right field, on the track, at the wall, see ya! A game-winning home run by Derek Jeter!
That's what you live for. I mean, I love the postseason. Not taking anything away from the regular season, but when it means the most, that's when I want to play.
And do you feel like that's what separates the stars from the superstars?
Well, I wouldn't call myself a superstar by no stretch of the imagination, but I think you look at all the people here, you rise to the occasion when your team or individual sport, when you need to do it the most.
Is it easier in an individual sport or harder? I mean, would you rather have teammates or is it easier to go out there and play?
I think it's harder.
I couldn't play with teammates. I'm selfish and I couldn't rely on anyone else. I couldn't play with teammates.
Wow.
That's an overstatement, though.
That's cool. That is. Yeah. It's kind of like even with boxing, I feel like that to a degree is where when I'm around, I tell them I don't mix well with other fighters because I don't know when you might be looking at me wrong. And when you do, this is something gonna go down. You know what I mean? So I don't mix well with others. However, I have played team sports. I played basketball before, and it's like when I play, I understand it's just about the whole morale for the team. It's kind of like Yao Ming said, the team comes first.
So you don't have to worry about if your teammate's not feeling well, if he might make a mistake, it's all on you.
That's right, and see, what I like most about that is I can't blame somebody else. If something goes wrong, I want to be responsible. Tell me I did it.
Now, but if you look at a team sport also, it gets to a point where the pressure's on the star. You know, I don't care if you do have teammates. It's about how well you play.
I mean, it changes. Blame, right? Claim. That's what it is. The blame and the claim sits with the star.
I mean, yes.
You're right. You get way more than you deserve, and you can get way more than you don't.
I mean, but the word that she just mentioned was selfish. Everybody's, I think we all are selfish in some respect, because I think to be successful, you have to somewhat have a tunnel vision about how you want to, or you perceive yourself. Either you're going to deal with certain things, you're not going to deal with certain things, you're going to, you know, that day that you don't want to hang out with people, you're going to do things that you can work out on your own. You're selfish in your own right. Every successful person has to be. That's the only way you're going to get the tunnel vision to be successful. Now, how you channel that selfishness in our game, the team sport, you have to give up some of it, but we still have it because we have individual, you know, goals that we try to meet. They have to maintain it because they don't have anybody else that they got to rely upon. So selfish plays a big part in all of successful athletes or, you know, business, because you have to have the focus to make sure you do what you have to do. You don't care about anybody else to that degree so that you can be successful.
For all of you, your parents played such a strong role as you were coming up and part of everything. How important was that?
My parents were huge. I mean, I remember growing up, this is all I ever wanted to do. My father was a shortstop, so I wanted to be just like him. And they're always real supportive, you know, never negative. But that's where my desire to win at everything came from, my father. He used to beat me down in everything we did. We played The Price is Right, man. I'm 5, 6 years old, going to afternoon kindergarten, and we playing the Showcase Showdown. I don't know the price of a refrigerator. He would beat me down, and I would walk to school after that. So that's why now I want to win. If you tell me you want to race down the street, I'm going to try to beat you.
How'd you get started playing football?
I was too short to play basketball.
But you played basketball.
Yeah.
Football was your best sport?
Well, the thing about it was my older brothers were all running backs. And I guess that vision and all everything that they had just built into me into a big, healthy guy, you know, because I still say I'm a safety, but I'm trapped in a 300-pound body, you know what I'm saying? I think like a little man. So when you think like a little man, you can move like a little man.
So boxing was always your favorite sport?
Yeah, pretty much in the beginning, because it was just something about me that when the first time I saw Muhammad Ali, I knew that's what I wanted to do.
There's the quickness and the power of Roy Jones.
We've let the cat out of the bag. He can do anything.
He excited the boxing world, and he dominated the fight.
And Derek, you said baseball is because your father played baseball.
I just wanted to be him. You know, I'm too skinny to play football. I mean, I can't be running up and down with these guys. I'm not going to fight. And basketball is too much running. And tennis is back and forth too much. Baseball, you go 90 feet, take a break. So I followed him in his footsteps. You know, he still tells me he's better today. He just couldn't hit. He just couldn't hit.
Michael, you played football.
Huh?
Baseball, too.
I mean, in high school, we all tried to do a...
No, I said baseball, too.
I mean, baseball was my love.
When you were a kid. Baseball is what you like more than basketball.
I started baseball when I was 6 years old, and I played all through high school. But my skills actually started to gear more towards basketball, which, you know, obviously in high school, everybody plays. I mean, I imagine he played three sports. I played three sports.
We all did.
And we do anything to get out of class, right?
Just get out of the house.
Skip class early.
The enjoyment of the game sort of rivaled baseball? I mean, baseball...
No. It's the thing I like about baseball is the camaraderie, you know, being in the dugout, hanging out with the guys pretty much the whole time. I mean, when I played in minor leagues with that 2-year stint, I mean, that was the best time I ever had, because you see such a strong passion for the game, but yet you hang out together. It's like, you know, it's like a gang. You always, you know, you cover each other's back. You know, you go out, you eat together, you do everything basically together. Basketball is a little bit different, you know, especially professionally, because you get away, it's not as many people. Guys go every which way. You may meet up at certain times, but the camaraderie is not quite the same, you know, and that's what I kind of missed in baseball. And it's a beautiful thing. I love it.
Camaraderie. Serena, The only camaraderie you'd have would be your sister in your sport. I mean, tennis players don't hang out together. I mean, that's your opponent.
Yeah.
So you guys don't really hang out together.
No, not really.
Did you and your sister fight? That's what I want to know. How much talking goes on when you playing each other?
We do not fight. We've never fought.
Come on.
Because you know when you're playing each other, it's all whoever wins, whatever. But seriously,
it is, because
how bad do you want to beat her?
I always want to win. I always really, because she used to always beat me when we were younger. You know,
now you're getting her back.
Uh-huh. Yeah, now that's a comeback.
Now you're getting her back.
Yeah,
no, I used to never win. First tournament I ever played, she actually, you know, beat me in the finals. And it was cool, you know, she was so nice. The winner got a gold trophy and the runner-up got the silver trophy.
The loser.
I didn't want to say loser. I was the runner-up. We got the silver trophy, but she was so sweet. She said, you know, Serena, I like the silver more. Why don't you take the gold? You know, that really meant a lot to me.
You know, that upset you more than you can believe.
No, I really felt special.
You used to beat your brother down on the basketball court.
Yeah, but we didn't gold and silver. We didn't get no trophies. Hey, he wouldn't give me the gold. Believe me, he wouldn't give me the gold.
Mine
That's
either.
Nice.
No, we never really fought.
Baby of six.
What?
When you're the baby of six or the baby of any family, when you get to the point where you can win,
you're the baby?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, me too.
You want to be the best. You want to kill them.
But I also think that happens with, like, girls are more like motherly-type figures, whereas us and your brother, no.
Forget it.
No. You lose, he going to stomp you every time he can. Ooh. And if you got a broke ankle or something, good.
Yeah.
My.
This is you. This is you right there at the U.S. Open. You, come on. You, that's you. You serve for match. Ooh, that's great.
Venus?
Yes, Daddy?
Get me four balls real fast. Put it away. Let's go. Right. Now, here you go. She's back at your face. There you go.
If there was one thing in your career that you could do over, what would it be?
Actually, I get two.
No, you get one.
Well, damn it, I say I get two.
Okay,
so
what are
get
they?
Two.
What are they?
Jerry Rice and Chad Clifton getting up off the ground. That's it.
See if they pass, and they do. When it's Sapp, you think he loves it? Warren Sapp for the touchdown. I mean, is that all he's got?
The pogo stick.
You have all had such illustrious careers, and you have a Super Bowl championship. Huh?
I'm not done.
No. Oh, no, that's true. You're not done.
You said it like we were done.
No, but at this point, you've all had illustrious careers. If there was one thing in your career that you could do over, what would it be?
Actually, two things.
No, you get one.
Actually, I get two.
No, you get one.
Well, damn it, I say I get two.
Okay,
so
what are they?
Two.
What are they?
Jerry Rice and Chad Clifton getting up off the ground. That's it. It's only two black marks on my record.
That's the only thing you like to do over.
I grabbed Jerry Rice, and he got an ACL tear.
Warren Sapp grabbed up around the neck and brought down Jerry Rice, and Rice is injured.
And I guess ripped Chad Clifton's pelvis out of place or something. So.
He lays out Clifton, and now they have to get Clifton on a stretcher just to get him off the field.
Those only two.
Derek?
What would I change about my career?
If there was one thing that you could do over.
I wouldn't have slid head first on opening day last year.
And now throw down a third. How about Jeter? A collision. He's in agony.
I do it a lot. But
all
that,
the time.
That particular one, I wouldn't have done. That's the only time I've really been injured. Yeah, you're always hurt. You can play hurt, but you can't play injured. So that's the only thing I would change.
1998, French Open, I should have won.
Serena Williams, 2 points from victory.
She's feeling good.
And another error.
Hard lesson for Serena Williams to learn.
So close to victory.
I had 2 points from the match. Still dream about it.
Me?
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't change anything. And the reason being is that through all your good and all your bad, you learn and you grow. Things fall in place for a reason. And if I change it, then I'm afraid it affects something else that was either positive. You know, obviously you don't want negatives in your life, but they happen to be either make you stronger, learn from them, make you a better person. And I just wouldn't change anything. I just like the way my life has gone, good and bad. I mean, obviously you don't want bad, but the good and the bad kind of equal out. And I wouldn't change anything. I'd be afraid of it may get worse.
Derek, you've won a lot of championships. Is there one that's more important than any of the others?
You know, they're all a little bit different. Anytime you do something for the first time, it's going to be special. But I was young. I was 21 that first season, so it seemed like everything happened so quickly. It was a blur. But then every time you win, I mean, they're all pretty special. I don't know if you can rate them.
Winning at such an early age, did you think it was going to be natural you win every year? You know, when you win early, you just think, hey, this is the way it is. I'm going to win all the time.
Not really, because baseball is a humbling game. I mean, not necessarily winning or losing, but personally, you go out there, you can have a good week, terrible month. I mean, so you can never be too high or too low. You know, basketball, you take the perfect shot, you're going to make it. Roy hits someone square in the jaw, he's going to drop. Serena, perfect shot, same thing with Warren. Baseball, you can hit it perfect, but somebody might catch it. So it's a real humbling sport.
Any of your championship more important than the other one?
Yeah, but my fourth one was probably the most significant. So he went in on Father's Day. My father just passed in 93, and, you know, that was tough that I had the chance to go through a successful thing like that without him being around, and he had such an impact on me. That would be the most significant of all the championships, all the things that I've done that was more meaningful, you know, at the time because he wasn't around. And, you know, I was coming back, and it was Father's Day. It was like a written, you know, script.
The Chicago Bulls have won the NBA championship 4 in 6 years. An emotional moment for Michael Jordan. The tears are flowing.
Anytime you win, obviously, to do it over and over again is a big challenge because you got to get yourself mentally back to that hunger like you never really won, which is probably the most difficult thing to do, is to repeat doing something. You know, Warren's trying to learn. He'll know. It's tough.
You felt that coming.
It is hard.
It is.
I mean,
it is,
because the first time you're hungry.
I think it should be a rule in this league that you got to go through 7 years of just some messed up stuff. Some wild card losses, some divisionals, do some whole bunch of stuff, and then get to a championship. Because
to fully appreciate it?
About 70% of our team was in the first couple years. And when you win a championship like that, you just look around like, I still got all these guys. And, you know, Bobby Knight called John Gruden and said he couldn't get Quinn Buckner to make the extra bounce pass after the 76 championship. We couldn't get nobody to read their playbook Wednesday through Thursday. You see that?
How do you keep the edge? How do you stay hungry to win another one?
That's the toughest.
She said it's attitude.
I mean, how do you keep that attitude?
I mean, it's an attitude of domination. We talk about domination, talk about being the best. When you get a taste of success, you know, obviously, you know, well, in my case, in Chicago, we went from the bottom to the top, you know, and I was there 8 years before we, you know, got to a point where we could win. I saw each stage. And that wasn't fun. I mean, 6,000 people in the stands to where now everybody's coming watching. You sold out the arenas, but you were not winning, you know. And when you go through all that and you win for the first time, you don't want to go back down that stage. You don't want to go back down those steps. You want to stay there because that's a hard road.
In an individual sport, tennis, boxing, you're the target. Every tournament you play in, I don't care from the first match, just to get to the finals, you're going to get the best of the 300 ranked players gonna play better against you than they ever played against anybody because you got what they want.
Yeah, I've played plenty of people that you never heard of and they bring their A game that I've never seen play. Now they play someone else a little less tough, but for some reason when they go against me or Venus, it's like they bring the best of the best, like they're number one that day. And I'm thinking, gee, well, why aren't they ranked number one in the world? Right. I tell Vince, right. Who don't want to be the Williams sister?
Right.
You know, it sounds great. I know I do. I get, you know, so.
That's their championship.
It really is.
That's the championship game.
So I always have that attitude that they're going to play me the best because why not?
But Roy, in boxing, everybody wants to beat Roy Jones.
Not only do everybody want to beat Roy Jones, everybody wants to see somebody beat Roy Jones. That's the bad thing about it. If you just do good, oh, he won. Come on, baby. The scorecard don't say that.
You know what I'm saying? That was his good call. Say, just because he did good and did better than what they normally do, he is alive, okay. He did survive. You know, but that doesn't mean he won. He just survived with his life. I just wasn't in the killing mood that day, maybe. The lion wasn't hungry, you know?
But when I wake up in the morning, I know somebody out there running hard trying to get themselves right to beat me. So either I can lay there and accept it, I can get up and get my behind on the road, too.
Team sports, when the Bulls would go into town, that was the biggest game of the year because that was their sort of championship game. Yankees, you go someplace, it packed the place because people want to beat them. And boxing,
hold on, you forgot Sapp.
About what? They definitely come to see them Bucks. Well, they definitely come to see that D get down. Oh, he can say what he want. I ain't sold out one stadium in this town. I sold out two. Two stadiums in one time. I got 80,000 on the waiting list waiting to get in there. I sold out two stadiums in one city.
Try to make the playoffs for next year, please.
Shut up.
The Buccaneers with the ultimate exclamation point on it from 0-26 to Super Bowl champions.
The last shot Michael Jordan will ever take in the NBA.
When you win a lot, you guys have all won a lot, that people start, and you were just saying, you won a lot.
I'm not worried about him.
When you won a lot.
I'm not worried about him.
But people start
hate
looking
you.
For you to lose.
They start to hate you.
Oh. I mean, it got to the point when the Bulls had won 4 or 5 championships, they wanted them to lose. Yankees, they want them to use.
Florida Marlins.
Oh. Serena was at the World Series rooting for the Marlins.
Yes, I was. Yes, I was just in Florida. Yeah.
You're rooting for the Marlins too. I saw you.
I was rooting for baseball.
All right.
It just like I say, you thank God for putting you in a position where they can hate you, because if they hate you like that, you're doing something right. Now, what almost happened to me one day, and this is the only time I may have almost lost my cool, when the Bulls was winning a lot. I always been a Michael Jordan fan. This guy comes up to me, this guy from my city, and we just got to play basketball. And he comes outside and he says, you know what? Man, everybody's talking, he said, nah, Scottie Pippen the best player on that team. I stopped. I said, you know what? And at this time, honestly, I swear to God, I haven't never even met Michael before. I said, don't ever say that around me again. Matter of fact, I'm gonna go home. Cause if you say that one more time to me, I'm going to jail. You understand me? I'm going to jail. And that's not only just for him. When you see an athlete that you know God got his hands on, don't come tell me nothing like that. Because really, you telling me that you got no respect for what I do and nobody else that's really dominate what they do, dominating what they do.
So what is it that took you all to the next level? For you, was it your, all of a sudden, your tough physical regimen when you
for
start
me?
Lifting, when you start lifting weights and start doing everything to take you from this level to this level?
No, I mean, I think it's the recognition that you have a talent that someone else wants or they wish they had. And it's like what he says, I'm getting up, I'm beating everybody to the gym. You know, I mean, when I started lifting, I got tired of getting beat up. Detroit beat me down so bad, I was taking the physical beating and I had to physically get myself prepared to take more of the beating. But I mean, obviously, if you want to be the best, you know they're gonna come after you. And my work ethic improved because I knew people were trying to jump ahead of me or try to beat me, well, you know, be better than me. And I wouldn't let that happen, not individually.
Same sort of thought process with you, Serena?
With me, I just one day decided that I was tired of losing. I just woke up and I just said, look, I'm tired and I shouldn't be. I have a lot of talent and I think I'm pretty good. Why am I not winning, you know, at least 90% of the stuff that I'm in? And I just woke up and I said, no more. And I started practicing a little harder and I went out and worked a little harder and got the results.
There?
Well, see, the thing is, I play a sport it's run by stats. I don't care about stats because all I want to do is win. You can put up all the stats in the world. Who cares if you lose and go home? So I know there's people out there that do things better, put up more stats, but no one wants to win more than me. And that's just the mentality I have. So I'm still trying to get to the level that these guys are at, and Serena as well.
No, I'm not at that level. I'm trying to get
You at that level?
No.
We're all trying to get at Sapp level, really.
We're all trying to get the other level.
We've been talking about winning. What about losing? How does that affect you?
I can go play a city league basketball game. And if we lose, I would not sleep that night. Now, if I'm like that by city league basketball, and I probably got four more midgets on my team by my size, and we playing all kind of people, but if we lose, I don't sleep that night. As a matter of fact, me and one more of my players gonna call each other all night long, because what you doing that, man? You wanna go shoot some more shots or something? I mean, I can't take it. So if I ever was to lose a fight, I'd go put myself in a straitjacket.
Serena, how do you deal with losing? Are you a good loser? There's no such thing, is it?
No, I am. I used to really hate to lose. I abhorred it. When I lose, actually kind of brings me back down, and then it humbles me, and it makes me realize, okay, well, I need to practice on A, B, C, and D. And once I get those right, I go out and try not to lose again. But it's very upsetting, but it's not as upsetting as it used to be at one point.
How about for you?
I mean, I agree with her. I mean, losing is a learning process. I mean, no one wants to lose. I mean, I understand exactly what Roy's saying. I don't want to go in thinking I'm going to lose. But losing is something that has to happen to make you better as a winner, make you better as a person, as a player, you know, as an individual. So it's a process you have to go through, but you don't have to accept it. You just learn from it.
Most disappointing loss around the room?
My first championship game in St. Louis. End of the game, Sean King throws the last pass in the fifth row.
Throws the Hail Mary, far sideline, he threw it. Too far, knocked out of bounds, that's the ball game. Rams will play for the Super Bowl championship.
It was hard to walk off that field when I watched that one.
That's pretty tough Hail Mary.
Oh, my God, it's going to the fifth row. Hey, nobody got a shot. It was a bad day. That was a bad day right there. That one hurt.
Derek?
Maybe 2001 when we were playing Arizona. Now, we were two outs away from winning four in a row. I think if you put us in that situation 100 times, we would win 99 times. That particular game we lost.
Serena?
Can't talk about it.
That bad, huh? See, to this day, you still can't talk about it?
See, that's a winner right there. That's question. A winner.
I'm still trying to recover.
That's a winner.
Can you give me a hint? Not even a hint?
Yeah, it's pretty emotional.
I'm coming back, Serena. I'll be back in just a second. When you lost in 88, after beating...
That was even worse.
That was one of the worst. I mean, y'all, you ever see it in the Olympics? Gold medal match. Just beat up the guy and lose the match.
Park Si-Han is taking a thrashing. I don't know what they're waiting for. That's not a standing eight. I don't know what is.
That time, I was shook. I was really shook because I just couldn't understand that one. But after I thought about it, I realized, you know what? This got to be something God doing to me for a reason, because there's no way I can figure this one out. I mean, like she said, you got to go back and figure out about A, B, C, and D. Wasn't nothing wrong with none of them. So it wasn't my doing. And I could not control that. As a matter of fact, and I went to the back in Korea, no, I ain't got no business doing stuff like this. But the interpreter, they trying to get me to take my urine test and all this. Forget all that. Go right there while he's right next to me. Ask him in your language, do he think he won? Because you know what that means, right? So she asked him. He's like, nah, I didn't win. I said, you know what? I shook his hand, and I was cool with that because he didn't cheat me. The judges did.
Celebrity embraces you, but do you embrace celebrity back?
Every man will want for kids to know who he is
right on
the street and come up and ask for his autograph. Whether he said, whether he admitted, whether he tell the truth about it or not, every man would want that.
A Williams dethroned, a Williams champion. Serena Williams, the queen of the tennis world.
You are all famous people. Was there a defining moment when you realized you're famous?
Yeah, one time I was talking to an operator on the phone, you know, and you're doing your phone ordering.
Recognize
the voice. Yeah, I knew you were Serena because I recognized the voice. Like, okay.
That was the defining moment.
For me, yeah.
I remember the first time seeing someone wearing my jersey outside of the stadium, my first year. That's when I thought that was pretty special.
When I came back from the Olympics, I had people in every airport I went to waiting on me to greet me, to tell me how sorry it was that I got treated the way I was treated. I was like, wow.
I still haven't gotten to that point.
You haven't got to the point. Did you not, weren't we all hanging out one time when somebody said that if he was in a third world country, people wouldn't know who he was?
Yeah, that was, what, the other day?
It was the other day.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
You ain't got there yet?
Still haven't got there.
You there. Let me just tell you, you there. At least you think you are.
How about you, your defining moment?
Shoes, I mean, the whole shoe thing.
Money's gotta be the shoes.
Shoes.
You sure it's not the shoes?
I'm sure, Marlon.
When I first got into the pros, and they give you your own shoe, you can design your own shoe, blah, blah, blah. I mean, that's pretty big, I would assume.
Has it ever been a challenge to stay humble?
I think the game humbles you. Whenever you think you're at a point where it's just like riding a bike or, you know, playing hopscotch, becomes a whole, you know, trapezoid in front of you, and now you got to do some things. I mean, the game has a great way of humbling you at any moment. Whenever you think, I got it, those are the worst three words in sports. I got it. Mm-hmm. You ain't never got it.
Make a mistake. You get humble. In our society, you get humble mm-hmm. very quick.
Well, Derek, you playing in New York, humbling is just right around the corner. I think I read somewhere where you went to buy something, and the guy said, you're Derek Jeter. You suck.
Yeah, it was... Went to Circus
in
City. In New York.
Oh, I love it.
In Circus City, right in New York, the guy told me that. He just looked at me. He was a Ken Griffey Jr. fan. Yeah, I'm buying something from him. And he said, yeah, you suck. Ken Griffey Jr. is better. So you play in New York, you'll be humbled.
Hey, y'all, come get me. I'm going to go to jail right now.
I'm going to jail. And it started again.
The bail money is, you know. Nah, I ain't that bad, though.
What's the worst and the best part of being a celebrity? I mean, celebrity embraces you, but do you embrace celebrity back?
Well, we do. I mean, admiration is something that you just can't get. I mean, you earn. And once you have it, you know, you feel good about it. I mean, to have kids come up and ask you for an autograph or to wear your shoes or take a picture with you, all that, that's admiration. You love that. The thing that it also can trap you, I mean, being able to do some of the simple
privacy
things. Yeah, you lose your privacy. You're going to get interrupted. You're going to get bothered. You can't have time with your family. I mean, that's from my experience. I mean, the easiest things are the hardest thing, going to a mall or sitting down, having dinner with the family.
Pumping
where now
gas.
Someone comes up and say, can I get an autograph? Can I take a picture? You know, pumping gas. Those simple things like that.
Anything.
You lose. You know,
that's
frustrating because you want some of those things.
Is it an even trade-off?
I mean, yeah. I mean, obviously it's an even.
It's a better trade-off.
No, it's a better trade-off. Positive way out with the negative.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, positive way out with the negative.
Every man will want for kids to know who he is on the street and come up and ask for his autograph. Whether he said, whether he admitted, whether you tell the truth about it or not, every man would want that.
But what about it when it comes around to privacy? When you want to just do normal things, when your life is open.
Oh, you
not
hate
normal
it.
No more. When,
you hate it. You hate it.
When it's open. For instance, one. Now, if you ever have a tragedy, it's not private. It's public.
Oh, everything's public.
It's public.
Well, once you accept that admiration from the public eye, well, you make the contract and you make all that money, blah, blah, blah. Now you become a public figure, which in essence now the public's saying we should know practically everything about you, which is not true. I don't think that's correct, you know, for them to feel like they can see everything about you and know everything about you when you can't know everything about them, you know, in a sense. And I think that's kind of unfair.
For instance, in the tragedy with your father, it wasn't private. All of a sudden it became public. Now you have to not deal with it yourself, you know, with your family. You got to deal with everybody. How hard was that?
Well, that wasn't hard. I mean, because obviously when it becomes personal and it's so closed, I can care less what people think at that time. I mean, we do, and sometimes we do think about other people's perception of things. But when it comes to family, comes to something like that, dealing with it, I can care less what the public thinks. You know, I don't have to talk about it. I can say no comment, and I think they understand. You know, when they make the accusations or, you know, why things happen or whatever, you know, you can't do anything about that, you know, obviously. But I don't have to comment on it. I'm not going to bow down to your level. They say things to try to get your reaction so that you open up the door for criticism, open up the door for conversation. You know, you don't let it take control of you. As long as you're in control, you're fine. Once it takes control of you, now you're losing the battle.
Serena, you've done so many interviews. Is there any question that you know is coming and you hate answering it?
So, how does it feel to play your sister? I really abhor that one.
And you get it all the time?
All the time. On the street.
A little while ago.
I'm so dude.
You know?
So now you know not to ask her again.
I won't ask that one again, huh?
Well, I guess that's going to get edited.
I'm on the bad side.
Serena, what do you think about playing your big sister?
Wow. Well, for the younger sisters, we always look up to the big sister, and we always want to win because they're always older and ahead of us and always do, you know.
All right.
He has more stuff to live without, so let's go over there with a smart guy. What you got, Purple Love?
I can't live without TV.
Okay,
TV. That's what you were trying to get to, right?
Yes, that was my point.
Why start over there then? You're never going to get to the point.
I want to know your feelings about each other's sport. How do you feel about boxing?
How am I getting mad with somebody that he ain't never done nothing to me?
You mean to be able to fight him?
Yeah, I mean, he ain't done nothing to me. It ain't like he slapped my mama, then we really got a fight on.
Yeah, but that's a fight.
That's a fight. That's a fight within.
No, that's a fight. That's an art. That's a
fight. No, no, that's a fight.
The way he does it is an art.
That's a fight.
But he's fighting.
He's fighting.
You can hear it in his voice.
You can see it in his walk. It's a fight.
Serena? Baseball.
Mm-hmm, tell the truth.
And the Florida Marlins.
Well, this year I've really grown to really enjoy the sport. I used to think that it was a very easy sport. I didn't think you would get really physically involved. Like, you know, you just hit the ball. It seems like the people that stand in center field, you just stand there and catch. You know, I think, gosh, I could do that. You know, I thought it was just really simple and just, you know, who couldn't play baseball? But, you know, it's really intense. And, you know, the center fielder is running back and forth every time. And, I really have learned to appreciate the sport. And it's fun to watch. And how about the Marlins?
Love it.
We know she's a bandwagon jumper.
She was a Yankee fan a couple years ago.
She lives in Florida?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Hey, she didn't know a team was in Florida before this year. You know, I'm a fan of all sports, you know, and I watch these guys. I'm a big fan. The thing that I love the most is what we're doing now. I get to understand their minds and see how that correlates with what I use to play the game, you know, and that now when I watch them on TV, you know, I can almost know what they're thinking because I've heard the similarities in our personalities and the way that we prepare ourselves for battle and except for Roy. I know he's out to kill. Whoever's dumped in that ring, he's got that mentality.
It's a science.
Okay, you call it a science. I call it a crime.
Tell him again.
So you can learn a lot about people by what kind of pets they have. You got any pets?
Yeah.
What?
Dogs.
You got
two Maltese.
Two Maltese?
That's me and my kids do. I ain't got no, I mean, that's family dogs, but.
Two Maltese, huh?
I thought Labradors were family dogs.
Yeah, me too. Bigger, manly type dog.
My little daughter. Come on, you know what your little daughter wants. That's what she gets, at least in my house.
Okay.
Right.
So, what kind of dog do you have?
I have a Jack Russell Terrier and a pit bull.
A what?
Mm-hmm.
Pit bull.
Mm-hmm. Dick, you got any pets?
Mm-hmm. Scared of dogs.
Then you don't want to go to his house. He got 50 dogs.
No.
I got quite a few dogs. My dogs protect my chickens. You know, you gotta have an ecosystem. My dogs protect the chickens. My chickens, they think like I think, so I gotta have my chickens, you know what I mean? But I got cows, I got pigs, I got a whole farm. I got horses, I do it all.
Do you have any pets?
No, I do trigger fishing. I do fish, tropical fish. I'm like, gee, I was chased by a Doberman pincher when I was in elementary school. I had to run across the field every day, so I don't
do dogs. You're probably picking at it.
That's how you got so fast.
Yeah, I don't do dogs at all, baby, at all.
What is one thing you couldn't live without in your life?
My two kids.
My chickens.
Family.
Yeah, definitely my family.
I'd say that same. My family.
Okay, give me something like an object.
See, you didn't say that.
No, well, that's what I meant. Well, y'all went heavy.
Once you said family, that was it.
Oh, his family is over. That's it.
That. I'm talking about a black.
Well, you shouldn't ask a football player.
What are you talking about? I mean,
there's one. Ask a football player. Football player, very intelligent.
I didn't say that.
Yes, you did.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Start on the more intelligent end, over this side.
Start with the old guy.
Man, you stay there.
I can't change now.
He has more stuff to live without. So let's go over there with a smart guy. What you got, Purple Love?
I can't live without TV.
Okay,
TV. That's what you were trying to get to, right?
Yeah, okay. That was my point.
Dude, why start over there then? You're never going to get to the point.
A house.
Mobile phone.
Mm-hmm.
That
thing you got with all the stuff on it.
The two-way, huh?
Yeah.
Boy, if somebody took that, you'd faint.
I got a lock on it, though.
You can have all that, just do not bother my daggone chicken, like I said. You can have all that cell phone, all that TV, you can have all that, just don't bother my chickens.
Tell me your impressions of each person here in terms of sports. Your impressions of Warren.
Wannabe. He want to be with us. Multi-championships. Wannabe. Okay.
I'm gonna kick his ass.
He's a fun, loving guy. He can take my joke. He's a legend, I think. Roy is he epitomizes what a gladiator is all about. He has a certain vision about being the best at something, and he's gonna do everything he can, intimidate, aggravate, and then kill, basically, when the time comes.
Derek?
Derek is a consummate pro. I mean, I think he can compliment anybody on the field. He's always thinking about the little things. You know, when you watch him in the Yankees, when he made that play at home plate, a lot of guys wouldn't do that, and now he's made his team that much better.
Serena?
She's innovating the game. I mean, she's shown where, you know, she can, versatility has come into play. She can get to, her speed is just as good, her power is just as good. I mean, and plus, she's bringing back full-figured, voluptuous people. You don't have to be thin, right?
No, not at all.
That's my girl.
Say it, MJ.
That's my opinion. Right, can I leave?
Derek, your impressions of each person.
Warren, he has fun. That's what I like. He's out there, he's having a good time, like he's playing a high school football game. A lot of times you see athletes, professional athletes nowadays, it doesn't look like they're having fun. They're just going through the motions. He enjoys himself. Roy, what can you say about Roy? I'm his biggest fan. No, I can't kill nobody for you. I would try. I'm betting on you all the time.
I appreciate that, brother.
But Roy, I mean, he is the Michael Jordan of boxing. The best. Gain weight, lose weight, do whatever you got to do. But he's someone I look up to. Now, Serena makes tennis fun. And I wasn't a big tennis fan. You know, I dabbled in it when I was younger, but I really enjoyed watching her play tennis. And I mean, the power, I'd like to play sometime. I mean, you're seeing all the, because we hit 90 mile an hour fastballs, but that can't compare to these serves. I mean, she's moving around power game speed. She just blows people away. I mean, MJ, he's what every athlete wants to be. You know, how he handles himself on the court, off the court. I think you ask everyone here, we'd like to be Michael Jordan of our sports. He's the measuring stick.
This is wonderful just to have you guys here all together, the best of the best, and I hope that you've enjoyed at least having a chance to interact with each other.
I've enjoyed it.
And get a chance to know one another and realize that you guys are all on the same plane in terms of trying to do what you're trying to do. And that's it. Give me the first thing that comes to your mind, all right? Funk.
Locker room.
Marriage.
Not yet.
Transportation.
Dance.
Diet.
I need to go on one. these are set up, man.
I swear.
You see, all the single questions are getting to you.
Man, I forgot what I was going to say.
He wanted to see the guy laying down there bleeding. Is that not true?
He don't.
Would you want to win on the scorecard?
Not really. He come out messing with Roy. I mean, his mouth may not look the same ever again. When they play y'all, they want to beat y'all because you was champion.
I'm not a killer.
Oh, God.
When you do this, we show this show, put a poll up. Do you think Roy is a killer?
No.
Call in 1-800.
Hold on.
You're getting 95% saying killer, killer.
10 years from now, what will you be doing?
Hopefully, we're on a nice yacht somewhere, chilling.
So I'm fighting somebody by something.
Still playing.
Still playing.
Still watching.